Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are talking about one of my all-time favorite things, cranial fossae. This video will have considerable overlap with one of our dissection videos, but the goal here will be to discuss what traverses these foramina, whereas in the dissection video, we will focus more on how to actually locate and differentiate those foramina. So use these opportunities of overlap to find those areas where you may need to review more and really focus in on those. If you have something down pat, don't spend as much time there. Okay, so let's get started with the fun. And as mentioned before, we will focus on the cranial fossae, of which there are three. There's the anterior, the middle, and the posterior. And then we will talk about where these are located and which foramina or passageways are associated with each. All right. So let's get our bearings in terms of what we are looking at here. We are looking at a superior view of the cranial base or basocranium. So obviously the brain and meninges have been removed to better view the bone. And these shaded portions are depicting the divisions of the basocranium or the cranial fossae. This light blue is going to be depicting the anterior cranial fossa, which is bounded by the squama of the frontal bone, so this frontal bone here, kind of the forehead region, to the lesser wings of the sphenoid bone. So this is in general about where the lesser wings of the sphenoid are located. There is variation depending on sources regarding how far the anterior cranial fossa will extend medially. For our purposes, we are going to include this region right here that I am circling. Occasionally, that is associated with the middle cranial fossa in different resources. The gray portion of this image is representing the middle cranial fossa, and this is going to include the inferior portions of the lesser wings of the sphenoid, so kind of underneath the lesser wings, all the way to the apex of the petrous part of the sphenoid bones. So the temporal lobes and portions of the pituitary gland will sit in this region. And I forgot to mention, but the inferior and anterior portions of the frontal lobe will sit in the anterior cranial fossa. This yellow portion of the image indicates the expanse that is the posterior cranial fossa, which extends from the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone back to the squamous portion of the occipital bone, or kind of the flattened back part of the head. This is the deepest cranial fossa because I hope you can notice here that the fossae are organized in a stair-step fashion, with the anterior cranial fossa being the highest and the posterior cranial fossa being the lowest. I also hope you can get an indication that since it's deeper, it can have some more structures that are going to sit in here. So the occipital lobe, the cerebellum, and the brainstem are associated with the posterior cranial fossa. There are a lot of foramina or holes in this region, and these are passageways for neurovasculature to enter and exit, in fact, mostly exit the skull, or move to different parts of the head. During development, bone forms around the neurovasculature, so these foramina will vary in size and shape depending on what is traversing the foramina. So if it's something big, the foramen will be relatively bigger. If it's something small, the foramen will be small. So let's talk about some of these foramina, and most importantly in this video, we will focus on what is traversing the foramina. And as we often do, let's start anterior and work our way posterior. When you are in the anterior cranial fossa, you're really focusing on three bones. You have the frontal, which makes up the majority. You have the ethmoid, which is small, but really complex and important in this region. And then the sphenoid with these lesser wings here. Now there's quite a bit happening in this ethmoid region and comparatively less in the other portions. You will have all these small foramina throughout this region. And these are referred to as cribriform foramina, meaning sieve-like. And so this will be important in terms of the olfactory nerve axons traversing this region, so cranial nerve 1. There are also optic canals, which I'm going to circle here and here. These are going to lead into or away from the orbital region. So the ophthalmic artery, which is a branch of the ICA, is going to enter into the orbital region via this canal. And the optic nerve is going to exit the orbital region via this canal. Note that if you're using another resource, you may see the optic canals as a component of the middle cranial fossa, but we are going by the schemes in Gray's Anatomy. All right, moving to the middle cranial fossa, and there's a lot going on in this region, particularly the superior orbital fissure, which is difficult to see. It's tucked up under the lesser wings of the sphenoid. You can't even see it on this side. You can see it a bit more here in this anterior view. So a fairly large opening. And one of the things that all of these structures right here have in common is that they are heading for the orbit. And the oculomotor nerve will efferently serve 4 out of the 6 extraocular eye muscles in addition to carrying preganglionic parasympathetics, so hugely important in terms of the orbit. The trochlear nerve will innervate the superior oblique muscle, whereas the abducens nerve will innervate the lateral rectus muscle, so those 2 other extraocular eye muscles. V1, or the ophthalmic nerve, I hope you recall, is a purely sensory nerve. It will provide afferent innervation to the orbital region, as these other 3 were entirely efferent, so you need a sensory nerve. And lastly, the ophthalmic veins will traverse the superior orbital fissure, which will drain blood from the orbital region. So like I mentioned, a lot going on here, and this is why this opening is comparatively larger than some of the other openings into the orbital region. Continuing with the middle cranial fossa, there are 3 more foramina I want you to be familiar with and you're responsible for knowing. This pretty much perfect circle here, these are going to be the foramen rotundum by which V2, or the maxillary nerve, is going to exit the skull. This more oval-shaped and slightly larger foramen is the foramen ovale, and this is by which V3 is going to exit the skull. So V3 is larger, so it's going to be a larger foramen. And lastly, this little pinprick of a foramen is going to be, and it's kind of posterior lateral to the foramen ovale, is the foramen spinosum. And this allows the middle meningeal artery to enter the skull. So this is one of the cases where we're actually entering the skull, and this is to supply the meninges and may be important in cases of epidural hemorrhages. Before I move away from the middle cranial fossa, I do want to mention how the internal carotid artery enters the skull, as it's very important in terms of blood supply. And this is actually easiest to view from an inferior view, which is what we're looking at here. And you can see clearly this external opening of the carotid canal in the temporal bone. And you can even see in this image the foramen ovale and the foramen spinosum, which makes sense that you should be able to also see this in an inferior view. The internal carotid artery will enter the middle cranial fossa, kind of in this region here. It has, this region right here has a different name called the foramen lacerum, but it will, there'll be an opening by which the internal carotid enters into this region. It will enter into the cavernous sinuses, as we discussed, which are located on either side of the body of the sphenoid. So that's how that internal carotid is getting into the skull. Last but not least, we have the posterior cranial fossa foramina. And we are going to start with the internal acoustic meatus. It's not as easy to see here, but it'd be in this general region. And this is located on this petrous part of the temporal bone. So this kind of rock-like portion here is considered the petrous part. And it is leading, so this internal acoustic meatus is leading into the inner middle ear regions that are housed within the petrous part. So the facial nerve is going to enter in and eventually make its way out of the skull, whereas the vestibulocochlear nerve goes into this region and never goes out, which makes sense because within this petrous part, as mentioned, is the inner ear, and the vestibular cochlear nerve is going to play a direct role in terms of hearing and equilibrium. So it goes in and never comes out of the internal acoustic meatus region. One of my all-time favorite foramina are the jugular foramina, and you can see that even on either side, they look kind of different. And these, there's much going on in terms of this region, much traversing this region, and it is uniquely shaped. You can see kind of right around here a divot in the bone that is leading into the jugular foramen. And during life, the sigmoid dural venous sinus sat in this kind of divot right here. And it's draining blood from the brain. And once you get to the jugular foramen, you have that name change occur. And this is where the IJV, or the internal jugular vein, is going to start. So recall that internal jugular vein is that large vein in the neck, and all those dural venous sinuses are draining into it. Additionally, three cranial nerves will exit the skull via the jugular foramen. You have glossopharyngeal nerve, or cranial nerve 9, the vagus, or cranial nerve 10, and the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, which innervates the sternocleidomastoid and trapezius muscles. The most obvious foramen in the posterior cranial fossa, or kind of with throughout the entire skull, is the foramen magnum, which is the second largest foramen in the body. The largest is all the way down in the hip region. And it is here at the foramen magnum that the transition from the medulla oblongata to the spinal cord occurs. The accessory nerve will ascend through the foramen magnum. And that's odd because we just talked about the accessory nerve in association with the jugular foramen. Well, it is associated with both. The accessory nerve, which was formerly referred to as the spinal accessory nerve, originates from the spinal cord. It will ascend through the foramen magnum and then almost immediately will exit the skull via the jugular foramen. So associated with both the foramen magnum and the jugular foramen. The vertebral arteries will ascend through the foramen magnum as well to be a major supplier of blood to the brain. And lastly, the hypoglossal canals, which are very close to the foramen magnum, but kind of tucked up in this region here, are a little more difficult to ID. Close to the foramen magnum, it is through these hypoglossal canals that the hypoglossal nerves, or cranial nerves 12, will exit the skull to head towards the tongue. All right, excellent. We have reached the summary slide, which has some super fun tables. I highly recommend making your own tables, as well as the active act of creating can be helpful with consolidating knowledge. Thank you for your time and attention here, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.